Thank you for tuning into Stranger Advice. My name is John Zaskoda, and I'm your host. Sit back, relax, open your mind to any new possibilities, because the beginning is near, is near, is near, is near, is near, is near. Episode 13 of Stranger Advice features William J. Birnes, an American writer, editor, book publisher, and literary agent. He's best known as the active publisher of UFO Magazine and is a New York Times bestselling author. He holds a law degree and received a BA from New York University in 1966, and along with Detective Dr. Robert Keppel, Birnes co-authored The Riverman, about how serial killer Ted Bundy helped the police track the Green River Killer. He co-authored The Day After Roswell with Philip J. Corso. Birnes also heads up the investigation team on the History Channel's documentary series, UFO Hunters. We pick up the interview with Birnes now. There's a lot of things that are going on with you and in your life right now, but ultimately it all centers around UFOs. This is a topic that I've been fascinated by for some time. Just up the street for me is the Aurora incident, in which I've had the great pleasure of having Mr. Jim Mars take me through and walk through. But having that so close to home, it's always been something on the forefront of my mind. How did your career take you into ufology?
Well, basically, I mean, I was a true crime writer, and I was working for a motion picture company in Los Angeles doing, I was editing a book for them on POWs and MIAs from previous wars, and one of the people we were interviewing was Philip Corso. And we were interviewing him specifically because he was in charge of Little Switch, Big Switch, which was the prisoner swap at the end of the Korean War. And during the interviews, he began talking about his role in Army R&D as handling the Roswell material and the motion picture company. Again, I was only working for them. I was a literary agent. I wasn't writing anything. Mm-hmm. And he began talking about his career in Army R&D and his career in the Senate as an investigator and on a Kennedy assassination. And it was so fascinating that they asked me to see if I could sell those books, or at least put together books for the publisher, and I called the publisher that I was working with, Simon & Schuster, and they said that if you can deliver this book so that they could sell it in time for the 50th anniversary of Roswell, they would publish the book. Mm-hmm. So that's how I got involved. And then after the book was published and had made the New York Times bestseller list — this was the day after Roswell — and made the New York Times bestseller list, the people who owned UFO Magazine, who did the first review of the book, said they were having financial difficulties, the magazine wasn't doing well, could I get the movie company interested in either buying the magazine or investing in the magazine, you know, making it financially healthy again. Mm-hmm. So I brought them to the people who own the motion picture company that had purchased Philip Corso's life story rights, and they bought the magazine, and they invested in the magazine. And basically that's what happened for the next 5 to 7 years. And then after that they weren't making any money on the magazine either. And they said they were willing to sell it, and they actually gave it to me more than selling it. They licensed it to me. So, and that's how I got involved in the field. And then during we had a lot of writers, and then History Channel, the History Channel production company, came to us back in 2004 and wanted to use some of our writers for a UFO file show on the Russian Roswell. And in the negotiations, we were talking about the Russian Roswell, which I knew about, you know, Kapustin Yar and their secret UFO facility. Mm-hmm. And so, because I'd written a book back in 2001 at Warner for, called Unsolved UFO Mysteries. And one of the chapters in that book had to do with the mysterious UFO crash or something it's in Kyrgyzstan, but it's on the old Silk Route, the old trade route, the medieval trade route between Mongolia and Russia. It's an old route, and it's a really fascinating story about how the Soviet Army and the Soviet Air Force retrieved this crash, and people who went to this area while the crap was still on the ground experienced temporal dislocation. They were sick, their equipment wouldn't work, and then the Soviets came in and they used the sky crane to get this cylinder out of there. And even to this day, supposedly the the Kriegs who live in the area will not go there because they say it's either poisoned or something like that. So they wanted to hear that story, so I told that story, and then I was on the UFO files. I was one of the guest experts, and I just did appearances for about five other UFO files, and finally they picked up on a story in UFO Magazine about this guy, Pat Uskert, who was traveling around the area in Southern California, Arizona, finding out about people who had UFO encounters. And so Nancy, my wife, who's the editor of UFO Magazine, said that would be a great TV show. So I, you know, together with Pat, we packaged up a video and started sending it around. And first one company looked at it, then another company looked at it. Finally, History Channel saw it with the production company. They said, why don't you do another promo? And we did. And then the team, and I wasn't on the team originally, then the team that was in the promo, they and I were in another UFO files about deep sea diving for USOs. And the ratings were so high for that, that what they did was they ordered a pilot, and then from the pilot they ordered the TV series, which ran for three seasons. Then that series, it was a very expensive series to produce, then that series transformed into Ancient Aliens, which is now running in its third season, and I'm one of the people in that as well.
Yeah. And matter of fact, it seems that right now there's a resurgence of, well, I don't want to say a resurgence, I should probably say there is an kind of a reintroduction into ufology going on in television and popular mainstream television. And I think that it's in conjunction with the simple fact that we're getting to a point where we really can no longer deny that. Mainstream is, and I say that loosely, but is really starting to bring this subject up because it's on the minds of a lot of people. Now, that being said, what do you feel, through your experiences and your research, is the most compelling story, the absolute smoking gun for the existence of UFOs?
Well, you know, there are so many stories, and I mean, the smoking gun. Roswell is one because you've got this deathbed affidavit that the. That Walter Hout, who was the public information officer at the Roswell Army Airfield, he swore out. So that's one. You know, I mean, that's legally, that type of evidence is considered a smoking gun. You know, there's no two ways about it. Okay, so that's one smoking gun. Then, of course, there are the very compelling photographs that from Paul Trent and Rex Heflin back in the 50s and in the 60s, 1952, I think, and then again in 1965. These are photographs, real photographs of something, of a flying disc. It looks like a flying hubcap, actually, that people have really tried to debunk over the years, and all these photo experts in the military tried to debunk. But the thing that always got to me was, first of all, nobody could debunk them. You know, they try as they, no matter how hard they tried, they could not debunk these photographs. That's one. And they, you know, then they would come up with these crazy theories about why these things were hoaxed, or, you know, then the real photo analysts would pop up, and just scientifically, from angle of light, how the photos were resolved, and these were photos that are not Photoshop, these are before Photoshop, it would have taken a phenomenal amount, you know, the proportion, the size of the object against the background, the proportion of the depth of field, things like that, you know. People would say, oh, this is obviously a hubcap that's thrown into the air and then somebody photographed it. And then when you look at the real science of the photographs, you see that it couldn't have been a hubcap because the depth of field was such that for something to be that size in front of the lens, there would have to be all kinds of blurriness in the depth of field, and there wasn't. So that thing was clearly further away from the lens. Therefore, it had to have been larger than a hubcap. You know, things like that, you know, real science. Another smoking gun, to me, has always been when official government agencies or bureaus do something to a case where they are actually creating the hoax to show the case as a hoax, or they're actually doing something to manipulate the facts of the case. Okay, why would the government do something to manipulate the facts of the case, to create a hoax, to discredit the person, but discrediting the person falsely? Why would the government do that, or a government agency do that, if the case weren't real?
Right.
And those, to me, that's always been a smoking gun.
In looking at Hevlin's photos, this was a time before we really had desktop computers that had Adobe Photoshop on it that we'd go in and manipulate. These are pictures that even if they were to try to recreate them, it would have taken them, so it would have just been a stroke of luck to get this
right.
With the technology that they had. A stroke of luck that's almost impossible to try to capture this picture, throw a hubcap, make it all work. It just seems like too much for what they had available to them. And just like the Trent Farm photos, they look absolutely real. I just don't see how they could be retouched. Now, I'm not an expert, but they just look absolutely authentic. To go back to the day after Roswell. Now, this is a book that, again, you co-wrote with Corso. For those people who may not be familiar with who Philip J. Corso was, he was in the United States Army. He retired as a lieutenant colonel, and he said that he did research of extraterrestrial technology that resulted in technology that we use every day. Can you explain to me what that means? What technology did we get from this?
Well, he was simply a deputy to the director of Army R&D, Lieutenant General Arthur Trudeau. And when Arthur Trudeau came to Army R&D from Army Intelligence, he'd been an engineer originally. And when he came to R&D from Intelligence, one of the things that he discovered was that the Army had in its possession a cache of material from the UFO crash at Roswell. Okay, it had some circuitry. This is debris, so it's not as though this is, what they had was fully developed pieces. But they had, you know, this kind of memory metal, this metal that was like a foil that you crushed it and it popped back into shape. They had pieces of circuits you know, they didn't know what it was. They were just like pieces of silicon that were, how can I put it, chunks, very flat chunks the size of quarters. And they had this kind of a mini light, like a little flash, like a pen. And it was actually a laser cutting tool. So they had these things, and then they didn't know what they were. This was back in the 40s, and they didn't know what they were. So the head of Army R&D at the time went to the Senate, and the Senate said, look, if you make sure that this stuff, whatever it is, gets into the hands of those defense contractors who have the wherewithal, the expertise and the industrial capability to produce these things and get the patents for them, because we want these to have American patents. If you do that, then we will fund that research. And so that's exactly what happened. And Trudeau brought Corso over from the Maryland National Guard, where Corso was serving out his final year as a reserve officer, and said, look, you know, I'm not going to go into what their relationship was, but they had a, you know, they were friends. And he did that. He did that. And for the next two years during the Kennedy administration, Corso was the person getting this debris into the hands of American industry. And it turned out that those quarter-sized chunks of silicon turned out to be integrated circuits. And those integrated circuits went to IBM, and really in the space of just 3 years, we were our computers had shrunk from these room size, and I remember these computers back in the early 60s at the computer center where I went to school. They'd shrunk from the size of these massive devices, you know, that really filled up an entire room, to things that could actually sit on a table. I mean, they were minis. And that was one thing. And then, of course, the cutting tool turned out to be a laser. The material that was in the, that was around the bodies of these extraterrestrials or these creatures that were found dead in the wreckage, that became Kevlar. And we're still working, supposedly. Corso told me before he died that various companies are still working on trying to figure out how they got the tensile strength for that fabric, because it is almost as strong as a spider web. And of course, a spider web is, given the size of a spider web, the thinness and stuff, that's one of the strongest materials on the planet. You know, and so it was that kind of debris that was in the craft, plus, of course, the bodies of the other creatures who flew the thing. And so that's what Corso reverse engineered. And then this is the story he told us when we were interviewing him about POW MIAs. He also told us the story about the Kennedy assassination. That book was never published because he died, so the publisher canceled the book. But the and so that's the material. And that material supposedly, he said, fed a golden age of technology in the 1960s. Now, there's not... Oh, the other thing, of course, were these lenses that he said came from the middle eye of the creatures in the craft. And these lenses, he said, turned out to be light-collecting lenses. That was like night vision goggles. And sure enough, when you look at the development of night vision goggles, the big jump in the technology, I mean, there was night vision in World War II, but both the Germans and the British had it. We didn't have it. And in World War II, it took a huge power source to to power the headpieces that the troops would wear. They were on the sides of Panzer tanks and British Panther tanks. And what Fort Belvoir did was they were able to shrink the size of these things so that by the time of the Vietnam War, we basically had goggles as opposed to these huge power packs. And so in the history of night vision from Fort Belvoir, you see Arthur Trudeau, an Army R&D, given this tremendous credit for developing this.
Right. Do you believe that it could be possible that the old General Dynamics / Lockheed Martin now and the development of Skunk Works here in Fort Worth and it transcending out to different divisions across the United States began with the collection of this material and the information that they researched and were able to find out as a result of having all of that shipped here in one location?
Well, I think that it began with Roswell, and I think not with Aurora. That I think that's a whole different story. I mean, in fact, on UFO Hunters in the second season, we did a whole show on the Aurora mystery, and one of the things, I think we solved it, and you could see the show, it's on YouTube, you could get the DVD. Mm-hmm. One of the things we found out was that it was probably a metal-clad airship that these airships were being flown throughout the American Southwest in the 1890s, in fact, as early as the 1860s, and that it was like a sportsman's club. People would, these are rich guys, sportsmen, it was big in San Francisco and Arizona. They would, they would trick their airships out. It was very funny. They tricked them out. They'd put wings on them. They'd put, like, dragon heads on them. You know, we've seen drawings of these things. And, of course, people in the small towns, like Dublin, Texas, and Aurora, and Stephenville, Texas, because they were all roughly in the same area, they didn't know what they were. And these things would appear, and you'd have these judges, you know, and these politicians say, what's in the skies? What's in the skies? And then in the 1890s, as the Spanish-American War began to heat up, a lot of these people were, now remember, balloons were used in the military ever since Napoleon, okay? In fact, lighter than aircraft were probably flown by the Nazca Indians in Peru. So that's how far back lighter than air technology goes. You know, anybody seeing smoke rise and seeing ashes rise and seeing stuff like that realizes that things will levitate, things will rise on heat. So my point is that Napoleon used lighter than aircraft as for surveillance.
Were there any pictures of these planes that you're talking about?
There were no photographs in 1805 and 1806, but certainly there are a lot of drawings. And a lot of artists did stuff, but Abraham Lincoln himself viewed a lighter-than-aircraft. He was one of the first. He was the single first president to look at a potential military asset that was an aircraft, and that was Lincoln in 1861 when the Civil War began,
right.
and the Union used balloons as surveillance craft in the Civil War. So, I mean, this idea of military craft being lighter than aircraft goes back all the way to the 1860s and in the 1870s and 80s. So there is a story coming out of Stephenville, Texas, of the strange craft coming down in Stephenville, right near the town square, or in town, and the pilot said that his engine, and these were propelled by gasoline engines because we had combustion engines all the way back in the 1890s. And so, the pilot said that his engine wasn't working. And, then the next day or a few days later, there was this explosion when this craft collided with the well pump on Judge Proctor's farm. And, of course, there were all these mysteries about, oh, you know, it poisoned the water and stuff. Well, we spoke to the Oates family. We were at the Proctor farm. First of all, there was a thing about, oh, it never happened, right? That was one of the first things that was one of the arguments. And, of course, we took off. We went to the old pump house, which is still there, right? We removed the pump house, removed the well cap, and sure enough, the well was there. Okay, so that's first of all. Then we went into the well itself and found pieces of aluminum in the well, and we found pieces of aluminum in trees because the explosion threw it into trees. And, of course, the children had retrieved pieces of aluminum from the ground. We had them tested, and sure enough, this was aluminum that was manufactured before the 1950s because the alloy composition changed. So compare the story of the craft that came down in Stephenville and the sightings in Dublin right about the same time in 1897 with the fact that the water was never poisoned in the first place. What happened was the water lines, the supply lines from the well to the farm were clogged. So what they did was they pinched off the supply lines and just dug a new well. And that's what people did at that time. So we think we resolved the mystery that the Aurora crash was simply a balloon, a metal-clad balloon. And we found the grave. Jim Morris took us to the grave, and we used ground-penetrating radar, and we found there was indeed a corpse. It was an unmarked grave, and indeed there was a corpse in that area. You know, we found the outline of a corpse, a small person like a jockey. But the crash at Roswell was very different. I mean, there you had many, many eyewitnesses. We found out from the witnesses that people, staff sergeants or people working at the airbase, non-commissioned officers who were on the runways, had been seeing craft over the base for days before the crash. So it wasn't just the crash happened. That's when they knew there was something strange. People had been reporting that strange lights over the base, and so they talked about that. That was not a big mystery. And then the deathbed affidavit that was sworn out by Walter Hout was, again, it was stunning. I mean, he's the guy who gave the press release and then for years said all he knew was that his commanding officer, Blanchard, told him to give a press release. And then it turns out that he knew the whole story. He'd been to the crash site. He saw the bodies. He saw the craft. He saw the craft being loaded on top of a tarpaulin. He physically had a piece of the wreckage on his own desk until somebody came and took it away. And he kept the secret for the rest of his life. That material, some of it was flown directly to Fort Worth, and that's where the whole Jesse Marcel was humiliated by Roger Ramey. And in fact, what Hout said, which was so mind-boggling, was that Ramey came to Roswell. He flew to Roswell, had a meeting with the officer staff, the people who actually saw the material, and were at the crash site. They came up with the cover story. They all agreed to the cover story. And then Ramey double-crossed them all. He had to have done it with Blanchard's full compliance. He double-crossed them. He made Jesse Marcel, who was the senior officer at the crash site. There was another officer there called Sheridan Cabot, but he was a captain. He was a junior officer. Marcel was the senior officer there. And made Marcel look like a jerk. And, I mean, why would a base intelligence officer confuse a balloon with something strange? Makes no sense. Anyway, so that's what Hout did, and he swore out the affidavit, and basically, to me, that's the smoking gun.
Wow. That's really interesting. You know, as far as going back to the Aurora incident, you know, there was reports for a long time that, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, this went through, like, Washington, down through Chicago, Kansas,
well,
Oklahoma.
You know why?
And then once it got into Oklahoma, it started smoking, right? Like actual combustion oil.
You know why those reports happened? Because this reporter who was a signal officer for the Army, and the signal officer back in those days were intelligence officer. I forget the person's name, but he was a... he'd reported that a craft came down from Mars, and hit the water pump on the farm. And that was where all the stories started about what this thing really was. Nobody knew what it was. I mean, there were all these stories, but it was this newspaper report. I think it was in a Dallas newspaper that this thing came down from Mars, and they took this guy seriously because he was he was at the time or had been an Army signal officer. But yeah, you really have to use your own scientific kind of intuition here. Had it been an incredible spacecraft, why would it have crashed into a windmill? Now, remember, these well pumps were driven by the wind. So this was a pump sucking water out of a well. That's what this thing was. It wasn't just a windmill, it was a pump. And how would it have crashed into a slow-moving windmill? And believe me, the windmill wasn't all that big. So how could that have happened? And what we found there was aluminum. So aluminum is a product that was manufactured in the late 1800s. It was used in a lot of things. But it wasn't until the 1940s, after the war, late 40s, they began to change the alloy, because that's when you started having aluminum cookware. That's when we really started using aluminum foil, came in the 1950s. So that's why what we discovered. And then, of course, you had eyewitnesses to this thing coming down in Stephenville right about the same time. So, and then there were all these descriptions in the local papers about these craft that people were seeing. So this was not an anomalous event insofar as nobody knew what it was. People had been seeing things in the sky that turned out to be balloons. So, but the Roswell crash was different. And one of the fascinating things about it, of course, is that the material did go to Fort Worth, some of it. Some of it was trucked up, went to Fort Riley, Kansas, and then from there, it did go to Wright Field, and I think that Wright Field, more than any other facility, was the place where this material was tested. And if there are alien bodies, they would have gone to Wright Field. In fact, there's one story told by a Marine Lieutenant Colonel who was a war hero at the Battle of Okinawa, that in July 1947, his class at the National Air War College, and if you know what these military colleges are like, there's the Naval War College, there's the Army War College, there's the National Air War College. These colleges are, they take officers and they train the officers for senior officer or general staff status. So it's really an honor to be picked to go to these, because that your career is really taking off when you're picked for this. So in any event, this person's name was Marion Magruder, Blackjack, a Black Mac Magruder, and he and his class were flown to Wright Field, where they actually saw the debris. That's why we know it was at Wright Field. They actually saw the debris from the crash at Roswell, but they were shown a live alien. And this is the thing that really gets me. They actually saw this live alien, and Magruder said that, now Magruder actually had a history. I mean, this is not some mystery guy, you know, who you don't know anything about. Magruder, after he left the military, turned out to be one of the largest McDonald's franchise holders in the Southwest. He became a very wealthy businessman, kind of like the Herman Cain of his day, you know, with all the Godfather pizzas. Well, this guy owned a lot of McDonald's, from the 1960s on. And in 1952, when they were living outside of Washington, during the two weekends that there were UFO incursions over the Washington, D.C. airspace, a black military car, a staff car, picked up Magruder at night and took him to the Pentagon, because Magruder was consulting on what was really going on, because obviously they knew, Magruder knew about UFOs. He was certainly in the loop. It was a very tight little loop, a very tightly kept secret. He knew about it because he'd seen the alien. And he described the alien. He described communicating with the alien. He told his children what the alien kind of communicated to him. And he kept this secret, really, until he was dying. He was dying of cancer. It was in the 1990s. And that's when he told his children and his grandchildren. Now, imagine that. You know, your father and your grandfather tells you this incredible story. And his son, his youngest son, knew something was up because on the night that the broadcast came from the moon about the first moon landing, you know, up when Apollo landed on the moon, and the son said to the father, "Wow, isn't that amazing? You know, I wonder if there are creatures out there in space." And Magruder said to his son, "I know for a fact there are creatures out there in space, but I can't tell you anymore."
Wow.
And you'd say to yourself, and that's mind-blowing, right?
Absolutely.
And so for the next 30 years, they waited to hear the full story. And, of course, they did hear the full story in 98 when Magruder died. And it's a mind-boggling story how he encountered a live extraterrestrial at Wright Field when he was an officer in the National Air War College. Well, and you'd say to yourself, and the same thing happened with the Roswell witnesses. Frankie Rowe's father, who was a fireman, kept the secret until he died. Alpha Boyd's father, who was a maintenance man at the Roswell Army Air Force Base, who actually saw a live alien being taken into the hangar. All these people, and George Wilcox, who was the sheriff, all these people kept the secret. And here's the reason they kept the secret. On the one hand, first of all, if you're in the military, you do what you're ordered to do. So if the military tells you, if a senior officer says you never talk about this, you never talk about it, okay? That's one. This is before the age of WikiLeaks and this guy Manning who leaked all the stuff. This is before all that. You kept your secrets. We were at war, Cold War, but we were at war. And that was one. But two, you were so thoroughly investigated by interrogators from whatever agency was handling this inside the military, whether it's the CIA, whether it's the NSA, you know, whatever agency it was, that if you spilled, if you leaked who you might have told the story to, that person then came under scrutiny. So why would you tell your wife or your children about something you weren't supposed to and put them in the spotlight? No, you just kept it to yourself. Mm-hmm. And that's what happened.
www.ufomag.com is the place to go. Can you tell me a little bit about the magazine and how it developed?
Sure. Well, the magazine was started by Vicki Cooper and Sherry Stark, who would work together. Sherry Stark was a graphic arts person. Vicki was an editor and a journalist, and they worked at the local shopping center newspapers, probably in Century City in the 80s. And they came up with an idea to do a magazine really devoted to, and they called it California UFO. That was the original name. And it was basically this combination of UFO sightings and columnists in the field of UFO research, like Richard Hall, and who was very famous. But they also had interesting spiritual stuff in there as well. And the magazine developed through the 80s, from 1986 to the 1990s. And then Vicki Cooper married Don Ecker, and the two of them really ran the magazine editorially until they sold it to a company that formed up to buy it called UFO Magazine, Inc. They published the magazine from 1998 through 2003. It was 5 years. And then in 2003, basically, I was kind of their advisor. I wasn't paid. I sat on the editorial board. I would attend weekly meetings. It's really all I would do. And then finally in 2003, the magazine wasn't making any money, so the motion picture company said, "We're going to close it down." And I said, "Look, if I assume the liability for all the subscriptions, just give me the magazine." And I said, "Fine, we'll license it to you. You run it, and see how well you could do with it. And sure enough, I did. And my wife, Nancy, she's a novelist. She wrote a novel called Cleaning House in 1980, which was her senior thesis at Princeton, and was the editor-in-chief of a business-to-business publication back in the 1970s called Idea Source Guide, and she was the national editor for that. And she'd written two cookbooks, Cheaper and Better and Zapcraft, again, both published successfully in the 1990s. And she took over the editorial duties of the magazine. She was also a graphic artist. And so we published it from 2004 until today. So we've been publishing it for 7 years.
To switch gears again, you actually co-authored, is that correct, a book? How serial killer Ted Bundy helped the police track the Green River Killer, Gary Ridgway.
Yeah, well, that's a fascinating story. And we published that book, The Riverman, twice. Once in 1995, and then again in 2003. And the reason we published it twice was that in 1995, there was no resolution to the case. This was simply the story. And we didn't put in Gary Ridgway's name in 1995. It was simply Ted Bundy confessing to his crimes. And in the he was facing, right, he was on death row in Florida, and he was confessing to his crimes and telling the real story of his crimes. And it was the first time a serial killer ever got very detailed about what he did, why he did it. I mean, he was lying, but I mean, a lot of insight. Well, the funny thing about that book is that, and it was also Bob Keppel's personal story of how he became the chief criminal investigator for the state of Washington, dealing with serial killers, and the whole growth, by the way, of the FBI hits tracking program. You know, the FBI, the FBI VICAP, violent, it was the violent offender information a computer system called VICAP, how that came into being. And, of course, the homicide investigation tracking system HITS that came into being in the Northwest. And it's basically how police began to coalesce their information to track a certain kind of serial killer. And then how that information, which came into being in the 70s and 80s, really applied to the Green River murder investigation in the 1980s. It's just a fascinating story. Well, it started when Ted Bundy, who had been caught and was serving and was now on death row awaiting execution, contacted Bob Keppel in Washington when the story of the Green River Killer broke. And it was really, the Green River Killer stories were really headline-making stories because the police were on a merry-go-round trying to find Gary Ridgway. They didn't know who he was, and they thought they knew who he was, but they had no evidence. And so Keppel and Dave Reichert, who's now a congressman from the Seattle area, he was the sheriff. He wasn't the sheriff then. He was simply Keppel's junior officer. Keppel was at that point the chief criminal investigator for the entire state. They went down to Florida, to Stark Prison, where they conducted a series of interviews with Bundy behind bars on what he thought the Green River Killer was doing in terms of his MO, how he caught his victims. It was a brilliant series of insights. Bundy was like climbing the walls because this was his territory. And he was really saying things like, well, you know, the Green River Killer, he's not as good as I am. You know, he's, you know, a lesser person because, of course, he's killing prostitutes. Prostitutes are easy. I was killing these women that were tough. You know, I mean, it was really a fascinating competition in Bundy's mind between himself and the Green River Killer. But he gave police some phenomenal insights into how the Green River Killer was operating the first time that happened. Now, Keppel wrote a report about his conversations with Bundy, and that report went to the FBI, the Behavioral Science Unit at Quantico. That went to the FBI, and of course, that that particular report got into the hands of Thomas Harris, and that report, a real report, became the basis of Silence of the Lambs. Harris, Thomas Harris, took that report that Keppel wrote. So, meanwhile, we're busy writing Riverman.
Wow.
This is now 1990, and Keppel and I had begun writing Riverman, and I sold it to Simon & Schuster, and the first edition came out. And it came out first, believe it or not, it came out first in England. The British were fascinated by the book, and I sold it to a publishing company in England. And then Simon & Schuster bought it from us directly because, again, I'm a literary agent. I retained the North American rights, obviously. And so we sold it to Simon & Schuster. Then in 2003, Gary Ridgway was arrested. And he was arrested. And here's where UFOs and serial killers link. Gary Ridgway was arrested because between 1995 and of course, Ted Bundy told this incredible story, and Ted Bundy was right. He basically called this case, even one of the cases that the police had ascribed to Gary Ridgway, this person called Mina Agashev. She was a 30-some-odd-year-old prostitute. They were saying that Ridgway killed her. And, of course, Ridgway flew into a rage and said he would never kill her. And, of course, the reason he wouldn't kill her was she was in her 30s. She was too old for him. He only killed teenagers and kids in their young 20s. And, of course, Bundy absolutely said, you've got this case pinned on the wrong person. There's another killer for this woman. Don't pin it on the Green River killer. He didn't do it. And the police did it until they interrogated Ridgway, who said he didn't kill her. So Bundy turned out to be right all along. Bundy even said that the Green River killer had been in a spousal relationship or an intimate sexual relationship with someone, obviously a woman, because he was killing women. And he said that it was his mother who affected him mostly, that his mother was probably a prostitute. That's why he was killing prostitutes. And that the reasons there were these long breaks between murders was that Ridgway was that the Green River killer was in a relationship, and that's what was stopping him from killing. Turned out to be exactly right, spot on right. So Bundy knew what he was talking about. Well, in 2000, between 1995 and 2003, the police needed physical evidence, physical trace evidence, even though they had an eyewitness that put a person looking like Ridgway driving away one of the victims from one of the early crimes. They actually had that. They knew that it was a pickup truck that Ridgway used, and they had other descriptions of people fitting Ridgway's description from the prostitutes. Okay, so they had all this, and they were investigating Ridgway, and they'd given Ridgway a lie detector test, and they'd done a whole bunch of things. In fact, the joke at the Kenwood Trucking Painting Company where Ridgway worked was that they were calling him the Green River Killer. So they knew that he was a suspect, but they never had the physical evidence to file charges, because they knew that if they filed charges and he was acquitted, he could never be tried again. So they had to wait for something definitive. Well, late 1990s, a person called Kerry Mullis, who became a Nobel Prize winner, Kerry Mullis developed a technique for duplicating DNA. It's almost like photocopying DNA, so that there was no deviation from the original DNA and the copy. And that became tested in court. And once it became tested in court, it was valid evidence. Well, they had DNA trace evidence from the Green River Killer on some of the victims. So they ran the trace, and they had taken Gary Ridgway's DNA when he was first interrogated. They did a mouth swab. And sure enough, when they did the DNA test, when they duplicated DNA from the perpetrator, from the bodies of the victims, bingo. It was Ridgway's DNA. They arrested him. Ridgway made a deal, confessed to avoid the death penalty, and told the story. And the story he told was exactly what Bundy said he did. That became the second edition of the book, another 150 pages.
Wow.
And when we had that second edition, that's when Hawk Koch, who was our, who with whom I produced the movie Riverman at A&E, that's when he said, fine, now we can do this. And so they got Cary Elwes from A Princess Bride to play Bundy, and the movie was one of the highest rated movies on A&E, and that's the story of the Riverman. Here's the connection between UFOs and that.
Okay.
Kerry Mullis, well, as you know, the people who discovered DNA, the double helix of DNA, were Crick and Watson. And Crick and Watson said that the DNA was so intriguing that they believed that a race of extraterrestrials had colonized planets by spreading their DNA throughout the galaxy. And they called this theory panspermia, which is a race of extraterrestrials millions of years ago colonized planets by getting their DNA inserted into the DNA of various life forms, and that became their race. In other words, human beings are the aliens. Kerry Mullis, who was the one who came up with the duplicating process for DNA, said that he was told how to do this by extraterrestrials during alien contact.
It's amazing how everything kind of relates. You know, there's not really many mysteries. It's all right in front of us. We just got to look at it. And
I mean, I'm really impressed with Steve Bassett, only in that he pursued the idea. I mean, you have to really hand it to the guy. He, you know, people were saying, oh, you know, no, the White House is never going to get involved. Well, he pursued the idea of doing this petition. And of course, he gathered enough signatures. He was very assiduous in gathering signatures. And look, I mean, he has over 10,000 signatures, and 10,000 is kind of threshold for the White House. So in one form or another, the White House is going to, as a matter of law, the White House is going to have to respond to this petition. So you could say what you want to about whether they're going to disclose anything or not. It literally is, you know, in the case of working with this stuff, it's really baby steps. And look at the two petitions that have made it all the way to the 10,000 signature threshold. This blows my mind, where the White House must respond. It's UFOs. I mean, you know, go ahead and figure that, right? It's UFOs. But the other thing is decriminalizing marijuana. That blows my mind that the two petitions that have gone all the way to the White House are decriminalizing marijuana. And when you hear the story about how it was criminalized in the first place, that blows your mind. Really? I mean, I've got to tell you. I mean, you know, Ken Burns' documentary about prohibition is on the air, mm-hmm. and it's very much to the point, especially in modern times, of how small groups getting together basically are able to force their will on a majority, right? And then and the same thing happened when Harry, I love recent American history. The same thing happened when Harry Anslinger, who was out of a job. I mean, when Prohibition ended, Harry Anslinger, who was a Prohibition officer, was out of a job. But he was the son-in-law of, I think it was a Mellon. And so he came from a very powerful family. And basically what happened was he lobbied and lobbied and lobbied because the various states had passed, had criminalized marijuana. And of course it wasn't called marijuana back then. It wasn't called any, it was, the joke was that it was Mary Jane, and it was really called cannabis. And cannabis, you could buy it in a pharmacy. I mean, go into a pharmacy. When we went to an auction in Pennsylvania many, many years ago, we bought an old apothecary, if you know what an apothecary chest is. It's a chest where the pharmacies would have all the pharmaceuticals, right, in their little drawers. And, of course, one of the labels on one of the drawers was cannabis. So you realize it was perfectly legal. It was a drug that pharmacists the doctors would prescribe. It was a painkiller. It was an analgesic. And amazingly enough, what happened was that it was Anslinger who basically saw all these various state laws and lobbied Congress and then falsified American Medical Association stuff because the AMA, because doctors were prescribing it. And in fact, the U.S. has a patent on it. But when you look at that, right, and how that came into being in 1938, it was an astounding piece of legislation that was passed in the middle of the night. Nobody even read it. And that's the governing law today. So what's fascinating is that petition is sitting there ahead of the UFO petition. And so you've got two petitions on things that really, it just shows you what's on the minds of Americans, UFOs and decriminalizing marijuana. I think it's fascinating. Here's the thing. Human beings already have cannabinoids in their bodies. That's part of our hormone system. And a lot of the unnatural foods we eat, a lot of the processed foods, so suppress the body's production of cannabinoids that various diseases are rampant. Cancer, I mean, when they were exploring, you know, when they're looking at mummies, right, there are no cancers. Cancer is virtually a modern disease, right, starting up as we began to process food. I mean, and it's part of the urbanization process. So in any event, diabetes, things like that. So, but cannabinoids are part of our disease suppression system. So it is cannabis that excites the cannabinoids in our own system. Well, the fact is that that turns up in the Bible as part of the holy anointing oil. Canna, in the oil that Moses anoints Joshua with, is cannabis. And what's astounding is, at least to me, that it was never called marijuana. The name, the reason they're calling it, that Anslinger called it marijuana, is it was a racial slur because the Hispanics used it. That's how it got its name.
Crazy. Responsibly moving forward with understanding what the values are and understanding what it can do for us, not only biologically but economically, is something that we just... You know, we've got to investigate more, and just like the UFO petition, I hope it succeeds.
Well, that's what's so fascinating, how these two things wind up at the White House. It just blows my mind, you know?
Well, I tell you what, we're going to continue to do more research, and I hope we can talk to you again very soon. Until next time, I wish you well, and keep looking up at the skies.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.